Yeah.
It only goes downhill from there. So thank you all for being here on a Wednesday fall night. And I'm grateful to be here and to Gabriella for organizing us all. And I'm going to talk to us about borders and elites and money and trade and the migrants caught between all of them. And so we know that borders are artificial, they're not natural, and what ultimately determines where they're placed and what motivates them to be defended through walls and checkpoints and border policies is money, the love of money. So we go back to the establishment by force primarily of the current U.S.-Mexico southern border. And a recent book that I wrote with Williams Press at San Diego was How the West Was Won. J-U-A-N. How the West Was Won. Reimagining the U.S.-Mexico border, and I took us back in time to say the early to mid-1800s when the U.S.-Mexico border was as high up as the California-Oregon border and went all the way down to Port Arthur, Texas, and encompassed most of the western and southwestern United States. And in the introduction, in the opening chapter to the book, I explain how the institution of slavery, at bottom a despicable economic institution, was instrumental in building wealth for white America and its settlers. It created the current U.S.-Mexico border. It prompted, slavery did, Texas to create the Republic of Texas. To protect slavery. It prompted the Republic of Texas to join the United States to protect slavery. It prompted the United States to fight the U.S.-Mexican War to protect slavery, and then ultimately Texas to secede from the United States to protect slavery. And the desire to really extend the U.S. acquisition of the northern part of Mexico all the way to the Pacific Ocean was the added component of manifest destiny that was driven by the desire to reach trade, or to facilitate trade with Asia and build wealth for the United States and the white settlers. And later the Gadsden Purchase, which purchased the Tucson area, was sort of the final piece of the military and economic conquest of northern Mexico by the United States. And this ostensibly purchased land was actually coerced because it was purchased under the threat of, you saw what happened with Texas and California, and we just made a mistake in not taking this piece of southern Arizona for the Intercontinental Railroad. We need it now. And give it to us or we'll take it by force. So once that border was established, it's been enforced to protect against perceived threats to elite wealth, or it's been opened as necessary to serve elite interests. You can look at every sort of border policy through the lens of money and elite interests. So elites sometimes need labor. An example is during World War II, when Japanese Americans were interned and field workers were serving in the military or building the war machine, and that included a lot of Mexican Americans. The U.S. reached out to Mexican laborers and needed them to come in the Bracero program, but it only needed and wanted male workers. It didn't want their families to come with them. So women and children were left behind in the recruitment efforts for that field labor. Elites have always needed the most precarious workers who won't organize and demand fair wages and safe conditions. They want agricultural guest workers. And even during the Bracero program and now, they want undocumented workers as the most precarious workers. And at the borderlands, the maquiladora factories that are owned by U.S. and other global companies, the elites actually preferred women. Because in the words of Elvia Areola, who is a Latina law scholar, women were seen by the factory owners as docile and passive and unlikely to cause problems with union organizing. And the resultant borderlands femicides in Ciudad Juarez and elsewhere were fed by this borderland economic reality as well as toxic masculinity. So elites fear the entry of those who might be reliant on government services. So then you get the Trump public charge policy that's trying to amp up the exclusion of people or sending back people already here who are documented because of their reliance on government services. Elites fear refugees who might be devastated and need services, although economic studies show that refugees add more to the local economy than they take away. Or these refugees could be coming from countries with different systems and pose a threat to cherished U.S. systems of inequality and privilege, like the capitalist economic system and our legal system that supports all of that. So in 2020, Trump will accept the fewest number of refugees in history, 18,000, and allow states and local governments to block refugees in their region. But at the same time that the border restricts human entry, what is it let in? The border's always been open to commerce that benefits elites and multinational interests. So it could be products made south of the border that are assembled there, like electronics and appliances. It could be agricultural staples that are farmed by U.S. farmers, living off the largesse of the U.S. government through subsidies that allow them to unfairly compete with Mexican farmers. And there go crops, staple crops like corn, south of the border to compete with those Mexican farmers. It could be money that flows south of the border from U.S.-based hotel chains and retailers like Walmart, which is Mexico's largest private employer, like it is in 21 of the U.S. states, Home Depot, and other private employers. It could be U.S. gringos who go down to retire or for spring break, who are really going there as economic migrants because they see an economic opportunity to flock there to Mexico. And my Run for the Border book a few years ago, Run for the Border, Vice and Virtue in U.S.-Mexico Border Crossings, tried to situate licit and illicit border crossings and the reality of borders is open to goods and money flowing south, but not to humans trying to come north. So the lure of money even is able at times to involve the Mexico government through the Merida Initiative and other monies to basically impose a southern border in order to keep out and police migrants coming from the Northern Triangle, to keep them from even reaching the United States. And on top of that, you now have, as Jeanette mentioned, the Trump administration rule that prevents asylum applicants asylum applications from anybody who passed through another country on their way to the United States. You also have a history of U.S. immigration policy that's excluded those who or impeded their entry who are thought to be economic liabilities. So we've excluded routinely the disabled. During the Great Depression, Mexicans were kept out under the administrative rule that they might be a burden on local government. Heck, even during the Great Depression, states policed immigration. Like Colorado put up a sign and tried to keep out New Mexicans from coming to Colorado during the Great Depression. So you basically had borders everywhere at the state level. And they didn't need walls to be prejudiced and to do that. And derogatory Latino stereotypes are built around images that situate them as on a lower economic scale, as really deserving what they get, And these stereotypes are artificially constructed by elites, but in the aggregate, they all impose sort of borders of class around around Mexicanos and other Latinx people. Stereotypes such as low in intelligence, so why fund schools, public schools, reliance on welfare and government benefits, lazy and dirty and criminally inclined and drunkards and unwilling to assimilate. What a Washington political candidate a few years ago said about when he called English the language of economic opportunity, and he called Spanish the language of doormen, dishwashers, and fruit pickers. And he said, English is the language of doctors, dentists, and lawyers. And my Greasers and Gringos book tried to connect those derogatory images to injurious social policies and practices like our border. So what would change the realities and outcomes built around the power of money? I tried for sort of a bright script here, but even the prospect of coalition, you would think, what about coalition with like low-income worker and earner whites? What about that? Wouldn't they be able to align around the interest of class and against elites and their policies. But the 2016 Trump election showed that that is extremely difficult because you had voters, white impoverished voters, who basically elected an elitist whose policies would hurt them. And they did that because the race issue and the fear of losing racial dominance was more salient to them than economic solidarity. And studies show that that's why they voted the way they did, because they valued race more than they did the possibility of economic solidarity. And so my conclusion in one or two of my books has tried to draw on interest convergence, the sort of aging elite need for Mexican workers. There's a pretty blunt quote that one of my former colleagues here at the law school at CLU, who's now at Alabama, Richard Delgado, wrote, when he asked the question, who will make all those beds, empty those bedpans, and clean the rooms of the aging Anglo crowd? So there is a possibility of economic interest convergence around things like he suggests, like Social Security, although I don't think elites are reliant on the social security system. They're more reliant on intergenerational wealth and the preservation of institutions that preserve the power of wealth, and one of those institutions is race. And so I guess I'm going to have to rely on Gabriela's poetry to be an uplifting moment for us. And we're going to hear her poetry again in between. Okay, and then we will hear from all the way from Califas. We will hear from our my brother from another mother, in solidarity, who comes to us from San Diego State University, and has written books that they attracted my attention because you cited me in one of the books. So I was like, wow.
It's gotta be good.
It's gotta be good. And I heard him present, and we're like opening acts. Or I'm the opening act because he's like the headliner. He does multimedia stuff. And he's gonna tell you about a show that's part of what brought him to the Seattle area at an art gallery in West Seattle that opens on Saturday night and will be showing for 3 weeks, and he'll tell you about a reception that I think has wine for those of age, maybe, possibly, on Saturday night. But if you've heard of like the group Culture Clash, has anybody heard of Culture Clash, the comedy trio? You did a gig with them just a few weeks ago, I think. And so anything that's like That's like, I guess, from like lowriders in La Raza to liberal arts and sciences. He's got it covered. And his like his nickname is Memo. But we'll be hearing from William Naricho after we hear some poems.